Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
All right. It is a pleasure to be here, here at the Carmel Bach Festival, speaking on how Bach's music has influenced Hollywood. My name is John Wineglass. I am a composer. I actually kind of model my career after Bach. If anybody knows anything about music theory, he is the kind of the example as far as harmony and things of that sort. So I was born in Washington, D.C., started playing viola at the age of 6 years old, and then started touring with the youth orchestra at the age of 11. We would go to former Yugoslavia, former Soviet Union, travel all over the world, and that was my purpose in learning how to play and practice, literally was to travel. And so got to do a lot of that as a young kid, and then I went to college at American University, and then went to NYU to study composition, and where I studied composition with Della Gioia at the Juilliard School, but at NYU I studied technology and film scoring for motion pictures and television. Currently I am, like I say, I do a lot of things in film and TV. I am also a church organist. I consult basically with churches with their worship departments and helping them in music. We'll do everything from Handel's Messiah to Paul Balash rock music. So everything, spreading the gamut there. I tend to be in my lectures a little more interactive, so I'll be feeding off of you a lot here today. So I just wanted to give you a heads up on that and talk about the power of music. Music is a very powerful idiom. In film scoring, we have a term that we call leitmotifs, which are little motif ideas that signify basically to the brain different ideas. And how many of you got handouts here? Okay, so you got, great, this is great. Okay, all right, so what I wanna do is I wanna start off exemplifying this power of music and how we associate music, and later on we'll talk, as in the middle of my talk, about Bach and how his music has done this. But meanwhile, I want to demonstrate to you about the power of music, and I'm going to do that on the piano. So I want you to listen to what I'm playing, and what's the first thing that comes to your mind when you hear this piece of music? And feel free to lift your hand if you have the answer. So, okay. So I love this because I do this at different universities and different demographics, and I've kind of codified this for this audience. So let's see if we. I have a couple of testers in there. So let's see. Here we go. So. Very good. Give yourself a hand. Okay, here's the next one. There we go. very good. Okay, here's another one. These ideas, these are leitmotifs that are triggering memories in your brain, basically, to a certain thought or a certain time. And this is the premise of film scoring music, and we'll later tie in how Bach's music does that. So here's another one. Okay, Star Wars, but more specifically, Darth Vader. Yeah, that's his theme. That's his theme. That's kind of how we, again, a successful film composer is someone that can brand an idea, basically, musically. And this is what has made John Williams a very prolific and very famous composer. Here's another one. This is a little trickier one if you didn't watch a lot of TV in the 80s. So here we go. Does anyone know that one? Okay, that was a show called Doogie Howser. Do you remember Doogie Howser? Doogie Howser, the little young prodigy MD, yes. Okay, here's another one. Yeah, very good, very good, very good. Okay, here's another one, and these are different leitmotifs for different characters, so beware when you hear this. Let's see. Oh, yeah, here's one. Yeah, exactly. The Flintstones, right? Everybody got that one? Okay, here's... here's a trick. Here's another one. Can anyone name that one? It is a movie. Yes, it is a movie. We mentioned the movie. Someone mentioned the movie earlier. Star Wars. Okay, yes, it is Star Wars. Whose theme was that? Princess Leia. See, look at that. See? Princess Leia. It was Princess Leia's theme. And then we all know this one. Exactly, Superman. Okay. Now give yourselves a hand for that. That's great. see, these are all themes that trigger ideas, and that's the power of music. Music really, really resonates in our hearts and helps us to picture ideas. When you think of a rock song or a particular song, it'll take you back to when you were dating someone or a particular time. And what I want to, before we get to the crux of everything, I want to introduce to you some principles of film scoring music so that when I set up to talk about Bach later on, you kind of know the terminology. There was a film critic, and she actually is a dear friend of mine. She's University of Washington, Claudia Gortman, and she wrote a book called Unheard Melodies. And in there, she has seven principles that film scores use. They're kind of understood in the industry of how non-diegetic music works. Now, non-diegetic music is music that supports the narrative, meaning that it's underscore music, music that is not a part of the narrative. It upholds the narrative. And then there's diegetic music, which is music that is within the narrative. So if you're walking into a bar scene and you hear music on a radio in a bar scene, that is what we consider diegetic music. It's music that's part of the story. I'll be using those terms there on your paper. I have diegetic sound there, but it's the same concept. I'll be using those terms, so you'll need to understand that as I go through the rest of this lecture here. So are we clear on that? Non-diegetic music is music that supports the narrative. And then diegetic music is music that is within the narrative. Okay, so she has seven principles, and if you look on your outline here, the classical film music, principles of composition, mixing, and editing, these are principles that refer to non-diegetic music, music that is underscore music. And the first rule that she sets up is called the rule of invisibility, which is, by definition, the technical apparatus of a non-diegetic underscore music is not to be visible. What that means is a lot of times when you hear underscore music, when you're seeing Jaws or you hear those two notes that John Williams, you don't see a particular piano sitting there playing the music, right? No, it's supporting the scene that's there. So the technical apparatus is not within the visual. That's what we mean by invisibility. That's what when she refers to that. The next principle is the principle of inaudibility. And inaudibility, as she notes here, is music is not meant to be heard consciously. As such, it should subordinate itself to dialogue, to visuals, to the primary vehicles of the narrative. And that means that basically it's supposed to not be there. The only time people actually realize music is not in a scene is when it's not there. And that's a successful composer. If the music is detracting away from the dialogue or the or Foley or things like that sort, it's not a successful film score. I have a very good friend in Wynton Marsalis who doesn't compose music for film, and the very reason why he doesn't is that he says, if I write a trumpet line and that solo is there, I'm not gonna expect some director to come and tell me to take it out of the mix. Because he's a purist in that sense of wanting to write music artistically in that way. And so he would never make a very good film composer. A lot of film composers today, you have to have thick skin, because a lot of times when you go to a particular mix session, your music probably won't sound as what you thought it would sound like. Or it might be edited. It depends on what tier of a level of film composer that you are. So again, your music is to support the narrative. It's not to detract, and so it's inaudible in that way. Of course, the third principle she has here, she defines as signifier of emotions, and soundtrack music may set specific moods and emphasize particular emotions suggested in the narrative. But first and foremost, it is a signifier of emotion itself. So that's just the core thing of understanding that music is emotional, and the purpose of music in film is to create these emotions. If you've ever watched a film without the music, it's absolutely awful. I mean, there's no way. There are three tiers of sound when it comes to music. There's Foley, which is sound effects. There's dialogue, which is me speaking. And then there's music. And those are the three tiers of sound and in music. And a lot of times, I worked for a lot of the daytime shows in New York City, All My Children, As the World Turns, Days of Our Lives, Guiding Light, Passions. And those are a lot of shows that I wrote a lot of music for. And so a lot of times, I would actually have a director come in and say, could you save the scene? because a lot of times with the daytime shows, they're shooting 5 days a week. It's a grueling schedule, and they're moving. And they might have had a scene that the actors didn't really practice for. Susan Lucci had a bad day, you know? And so a lot of times the directors would say, well, can you save the scene with the music? Can you make it more emotional? So a lot of times you see in these soap operas, you know, there's that scene where there's that glare, and then there's this music that kind of undergirds that. That's the part of the emotion. And a lot of times we were asked to gear that up to save a particular scene from bad acting sometimes. Yeah, so not that Susan Lucci did any bad acting. I'm not saying that. I just want to, okay, yes, she's a dear friend. So, okay, so the fourth principle that Claudia talks about is the this notion of continuity. And we'll see that in one of the first clips. Actually, the first clip I have is from Mr. Holland's Opus, one of my favorite films. And Michael Kamen did the score. And it actually demonstrates all of these principles, and we'll walk through those. So the continuity, a lot of times, even in daytime TV, there are multiple scenes that go across, and so these scenes are tied in with music. So a lot of times there'll be a montage or something of that sort, and there would need to be something that would actually tie those things together. You're not going to get that in dialogue, because most of the times those scenes are without dialogue. You're not going to get it with Foley because those scenes are usually changing, you know, as far as the Foley content. So music is one of those things that ties those things together. Narrative cueing is, again, we just demonstrated that where I played a piece of music and you kind of figured out a character of some sort. She describes it as music gives a referential or narrative cues. If you look at the last installment of Star Wars, the prequel, the last, I think it's the Clones or something, the last installment, John Williams literally writes, and this is actually a no-no when it comes to film scoring music, but he's John Williams, so who's going to argue? He writes music from start to finish. And if you take it and you turn the movie off, it's like an opera. It's almost like an opera. It's fascinating because you hear all the different characters. They'll take a Princess Leia theme and they'll put it in a minor mode, and that's her being sad, or a major mode, her having a good day, or Luke Skywalker theme, and he does this magically through his art of composition. The sixth principle, I'm gonna get through these, is unity. And via repetition and variation of musical material instrumentation, music aids in the construction of formal and narrative unity. Unity, this is basically similar to continuity in the sense of having a theme. If you've ever seen, and I might show a clip here from, if we have enough time, from The Godfather, where you hear that theme throughout the whole picture. It's almost 3 hours long, and it's amazing how many times this theme pops up. That attributes to the unifying a musical landscape of the film, and it's a very potent thing for a film. The seventh principle, which is interesting, is breaking the rule. And she defines it as a given film score may violate any of the principles above, providing the violation is at the service of the other principles. And breaking the rule would be considered music that is diegetic. So diegetic music, or like we have a music that, which is a source that's visible on the screen or whose source is implied to be present in the action of the film, that is music that you would hear if you walk into a bar and you hear music, or you see someone sitting at the piano and they're playing music. That is breaking the rule of the classical principles that we have here that Claudia talks about. So again, the principles that we're talking about are referring to non-diegetic music. So anytime we're talking about any of these principles, we're talking about non-diegetic music, and diegetic music is music that is within narrative. If someone is playing a violin, like the Red Violin, Corigliano's score, I don't know if you've seen that movie, it's one of my favorites, love that score. There's a lot of scenes where Joshua Bell is playing, and that's considered diegetic music because you actually see the technical apparatus on the screen playing. So what I want to do is move to my first clip that displays all of these principles. This is a movie by, as we get into this, we're going to phase into Bach and his music. I will say right at the top here, a lot of Bach's music is used as, let me ask, what do you think a lot of Bach's music is used as, diegetic or non-diegetic? Let's get one person here. Non-diegetic? Actually, a lot of times, it's been used as both, actually, and we'll have both examples. I'll show both examples today. Typically, though, his music is used as diegetic music. So if you're walking into a high convoluted party, just a nice high society party, there's usually a string quartet playing, and they're usually doing, as we'll see, Brandenburg Concerto No. 3, as we heard very beautifully last night. We'll hear that in another clip later on. But a lot of times it is diegetic music. I'll have a couple of instances where it is non-diegetic music and they use it as underscore music. And we'll have plenty of examples of that. But the first cue I want to show you is Mr. Holland's Opus. It's the beginning of the scene. Michael Kamen was a brilliant composer. Actually, the first two films that I'm going to show you are music by him. I actually studied with his very close friend, Mark Snow, who did the music for Twilight Zone and X-Files, and very prominent TV composer, and did Smallville, kind of got me on my first opportunity to score for that show. So I will show this first clip. I think, are we ready? We're good. And then we'll talk about a little bit, so that I want to show you this so that when we start talking about the Bach examples, then you'll understand how this music interplays. And sometimes also, you will have instances where diegetic and non-diegetic coexist, okay? And you will see that in this example. So that's why I say this first clip actually breaks down all of the principles and is an example. This is why I ended up showing this particular clip. Okay. Should we shut the lights out or we're not? Okay, great. Okay. Are we there, Sal? Okay. There should be music here. Yeah. We'll get it going. Hold on here for a minute. Okay, give us a minute. We've got technical difficulties here. So the first scene I'm going to show you. Yes. Sure, that's great. Thank you.
What would somebody's main motivation be to write this non-diegetic music? Is it just committed to the money? Because, I mean, like with Willem Marsalis, he doesn't want anybody telling him, cut this out, do this or that.
Right.
The money is...
Okay, I think we got sound here. I'll answer that question, though. Are we good? Okay. A lot of times, it's just the fascination with movies. A lot of guys that I know, I mean, for me, I kind of fell into it because I started an internship at ABC Studios in New York City at All My Children, and that was with shot in the same building The View is shot in with Barbara Walters. And for me, it became just, I always enjoyed film music, and it just became a passion of mine. You can't necessarily be tied to your music, though, if you're going to work in this business, for sure, because a lot of times a director will come in and say, I want to change that up, or I've had friends who have written a brand new theme and they, for an old show, and they say, okay, we want the old theme back, you know. And so that's happened a lot. And so if you're tied to your music in that way, then you don't need to be doing this. And not that I'm not. I do a lot of concert hall music right now. In the next 2 weeks, I have a commission with the Cabrillo Music Festival. I have a premiere piece there with Maren Alsop conducting. And that's a piece that, yes, I wouldn't want anyone telling me to cut out the flute solo or something like that. That's music for me that is artistic, more artistic, I think, in that span. So are we good? Okay, so again, this clip, and there'll be a Q&A at the end for sure for more questions. So this clip is going to actually demonstrate all of these principles simultaneously. And it opens up with non-diegetic, and then it moves into a camera shot where there is the actor playing on piano, and that would be considered diegetic. And then it does this very interesting thing where diegetic and non-diegetic kind of happen at the same time. He starts to hear the music in his head, and so now it's part of the narrative, but serving as underscore as well with the opening sequence. So here we go. Can we turn the lights down? Yeah, great. Thank you. Thank you. orchestra. Okay, so that's an example of all of these principles here. An incredible score. That's actually, if anybody, how many have seen this movie? Oh, yeah, okay, yeah, it's a classic, definitely. Well, at the end, he recognizes his music, Richard Dreyfuss does, and it becomes his opus, and that's what the beginning. And again, that's a narrative kind of situation, a signifier. We don't understand it yet, you know. But we will later on. And then the second time you see this movie, then that has more significance as far as its placement. So we have all the principles exemplified here with invincibility. Again, initially when the cue started, you didn't see any, you didn't see a piano, you didn't see anything. Then you see Richard Dreyfuss, and then it comes. And then you start to see him. And that's breaking the rule of a diegetic music. But then there's inaudibility that's exemplified there as well, where there you didn't see a huge orchestra there, and then after a while he just gets off the piano, and so there's that law, that there's that principle that's showed there, and then the signifier of emotion, of course, is this heart-wrenching melody that later on gives you significance. You'll find out as the story goes on how significant. It's a very moving film if you haven't seen it. continuity, we have. Going from phase, we go from the credits to him playing the piano, to him standing up, to them, even the shot outside, where that is all kind of this carpet of music that layers all those scenes together. If you've ever seen music, if you watch that with no music, it's like, oh my gosh. So, you know, it's music is very vital in film. Narrative cueing, like I say, this is Mr. Holland's opus, so, it, you know, narratively, we're getting a story of who he is from the beginning, and then we'll later find out at the end of how moving and how deep this piece means to him. And then we have unity, of course. That theme goes throughout the film. And then, of course, you have the breaking the rule. I'm going a little fast here because I want to make sure I get all my clips in here. So then the next scene I want to show you are we good for that? Okay, this cue sets up another example of the principles that we have here. Let's show that one at 1650.
When a flat receives a note like this, it indicates that the note is to be played a half step lower. A piece based in the F major scale should have a flat sign, meaning that it's stable. Thank you.
stop it there, yeah. So again, this is continuity. We went through three different scenes there, and there's this continuity that the music kind of presents. This is, again, attributes of good film scoring writing, and Bach's music, as you'll see as the next examples shows, his music is used very well in this. Okay, so let's go to the third example, and this is where we even see how Bach's music actually influences rock music of the 50s. And this scene is very indicative of that. We're set for that. So this is a scene where, I won't give it away. We'll talk about it after we watch it. Here we go.
No impact on you in the last 5 months. Mr. Sullivan.
Yeah.
What kind of music do you like to listen to? Don't be afraid.
Rock and roll.
What about you?
Rock and roll.
Mm-hmm. You?
Classical.
Brown noser. Does anybody here like Johann Sebastian Bach? Other than you? I'll bet all of you, whether you know it or not, already like Johann Sebastian Bach. What's this called?
Lover's Concerto.
Who wrote it?
The Toys.
Wrong. That was Minuet in G, and it was written by Johann Sebastian Bach. And he wrote it in 1725. They are both prime examples of the Ionian scale. Now listen, and see if you can hear the connective tissue between what I just played and this.
Okay, so as you see, Bach's influence, some 200 years later, influenced this particular song being written by the Toys. And something that even in that culture of that day, kids were obviously familiar with and knew this music, but didn't associate it with Bach. And that's again in this scene we saw that there was diegetic music. This music was considered diegetic because we have the technical apparatus is actually in the scene. Dreyfus is playing the piano, and we see this person. So as far as the music being diegetic, these principles are important because they really give us a scope of how to talk about film music, which is why I really share these with you so that we're on the same page when I'm referring to things. Okay, so the next scene is typically how classical music or music of Bach or Beethoven is used in film music, usually in a diegetic setting. I play viola, so I've played a lot of quartets and a lot of jobs, things of that sort, for dignitaries and different people. And usually when you go to these big parties, it's a situation where you walk into and there's a string quartet playing. Well, in the movies, a lot of times, those are typical scenes in movies. And so this next clip that I'm about to show you is from a movie called Die Hard with Bruce Willis. And I'm not gonna show you we're gonna continue down the path, but I didn't include the first clip because the movie actually opens up with Brandenburg Concerto number 3. It actually opens up in this dinner scene, but for the sake of time, I've just gone to, oh no, okay, I'll show you that clip. That's at 2:21, right?
Right.
Great, okay, so we'll show you the opening here. Thank you. spot there. We're also not getting sound. Okay, sorry. Technical difficulties here. We're at 221, yep.
Ladies and gentlemen, I want to congratulate each and every one of you for making.
So this opening sequence, Mr. Takanaki comes into this big party, and we hear this string quartet playing the Brandenburg, and or this chamber group playing the Brandenburg. And again, that music is serving as Bach's music here is serving as a kind of diegetic thing. So we want to move to 1054. So again, we walk into the scene. Now again, we don't see the instruments, but it's kind of implied in the narrative that this is a party that we're at, and that we're having cocktails and things of that sort. And later on you will see, well, we won't see here today, but later on you'll see the quartet or string quartet there that's playing the actual work. And so it's acting in a diegetic form of music and serving in that way. Typically, this is how Bach's music is used, and Beethoven as well. I can't wait to show you the next clip because we'll get an example of that. Are we close to 1054? Yeah. So, are we there? Okay. So, again, Bach's music has been used as diegetic and non-diegetic music. In the diegetic form of things, it's usually in a situation where there's a party or things of that sort. I will show examples in a movie that was shot actually in the 1950s where it's actually used as underscore. It's actually the prelude in C, and we'll get to that later on. Okay, great. So. No, we need to be at 1054.
All right, those are the city engineers.
1054, yeah. Sorry, guys. 1054. 10 minutes in. Ten minutes. Yes. 10 minutes in. This is. Yes. Yes.
So movies like The Artist or that one movie that came out with Rock Runoff in the background.
Right.
Seems like diegetic music or non-diegetic music is coming up. It's becoming more popular to put classical pieces in the backdrop.
Exactly, yeah. And I'll show, I mean, that was happening even in the 50s. When we talk about composers like Bernard Herrmann, A lot of times, classical music was used in that sense, even back in the 50s, which is 40s and 50s is like the golden age of film music. Max Steiner and those composers, a lot of times, they were classical composers in their own right, and so they would lead back to the music supervisor to use a lot of music like Rachmaninoff or Shostakovich that would be used. I think it's becoming more popular even today, and people actually doing different arrangements of it. If you see in in particular scores, are we? Okay, we're almost there. It's 8 minutes, 10 minutes. Okay. Let's go. You know what? Let's just go on to number five. Let's go on to an hour and 43. Yeah. This next clip that I will show basically will be. It opens up with a little bit of. Kamen actually, he actually quotes Beethoven here. And again, he actually quotes it in his underscore, in the non-diegetic music. And if you've seen this movie, actually, it becomes the minor version of Ode to Joy becomes the protagonist's theme. That he actually uses, which is pretty phenomenal. And they actually ended up using a recording of the Ninth Symphony as the music. So let's see if we can get that going at 1:43. Yeah. Yes. Well, that's not always true. Some of these folks have estates, and so there's in some instances you are paying for it. I mean, there is like a 75-year thing, but there are some of the contemporary guys they are being used, but it's not always the case. But usually, you know, with Bach, that would certainly be the case, And it's just true to the tradition. There's a lot of composers now, even a lot of film composers today, that can't write in that idiom. And music today, actually, the film composer today is not like the film composer of the 40s and 50s. Like I was saying earlier to that question, we've had Korngold, you know, was a composer back then, Bernard Herrmann, and they came up in the school of the Juilliards and things of that sort. John Williams is another one, which is why he's so prolific, because he knows how to capture that and compositionally and make that work. Which is why his, like I said, the Star Wars thing is like a Wagnerian opera. It's amazing because you see how he works everything. Are we there?
This is not what he did exactly.
Okay. Okay, well, let's just... Okay. All right, yeah, I'm sorry for the difficulties here. It played fine at home, so I don't know. Okay, so... Okay, anyway, let's just, are we, okay, all right, let's just move on. Okay, all right, so let's go to, since you were away, this is a film that Max Steiner did the score, and Shirley Temple actually stars in this film. And Again, they've taken Ave Maria and adopted it from the Prelude number 1 in C major. And in this scene, it actually serves as underscore music. The father has gone away to war, and the mother gets a telegram to that effect, and she is, you know, the kids are pretty disheartened by it. So she says a prayer, and in the background you hear this prelude in C. So if we could get that going, that'd be great. I'm sorry. You know what? Let's have some questions. Let's have questions here. Yes. Yes.
The organ and the harpsichord.
Yes.
The piano wasn't even around.
Right.
What do you think, if the piano was around, would you think it would have been different music? Because the organ had such power in the church, it altered the state of consciousness.
Well, you know, the piano and organ, two very different instruments. Back then they had the piano forte, so it was a lighter kind of piano. I think the music would have been different. Only because of the actually harshness of the modern day piano. If you've ever played a real piano forte, it's very, 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 very soft touch. And so I think, and I know as a composer, I'm working on a piece right now for the Cabrillo Festival, and sonorities play a big role in orchestrating and things of that sort. So I think it would have been a lot different. Now the organ music, probably not so much so.
Harpsichord,
yeah. I mean, each instrument has its you know, attributes, and kind of contributes to the composing process. I know that's how it is for me. So.
The organ music sounds fantastic on the piano.
Oh yeah, exactly.
Right.
I wouldn't necessarily make that general. I mean, they're very different instruments. Yeah, very, very different instruments, and they cause different things in a composer's mind. I have a perfect pitch, and so I hear notes on the piano out of the, you know, without any reference, and so a lot of times those things working in, I hear music in colors and things of that sort. So if I composed a piece on a piano forte, it would come out much different than it would on a regular modern day piano. And I'm sure it would for Bach as well. Yeah. Another question. Yes. Yes.
So when composing for a movie, mm-hmm. Do you see the movie first and then write the music in for it?
A lot of times, yes, they do. When it comes to major motion pictures, that's like budgets of 30 million and up. A lot of times those films come to you pretty much finished, and then you are to lay the music in. With television though, a lot of times there's two approaches. There's approach of creating a music library. A lot of times when I wrote for All My Children, they would just give me 4 months to write a ton of music, which they would take and then put into the narrative. And then sometimes you're scoring to picture. So there's some particular scenes, like if there's a wedding scene, like I scored Kelly Ripa, she was getting married on All My Children, to her real life husband, Mark Consuelos. And I actually composed the music to her, to that scene. And so they sent me the scene, and then I had 3 days to basically write the song. We flew in an artist from LA and recorded a song at Sony Music Studios, and that was the process of that. So it varies, it varies. With technology, things have made, it's been made easier to be able to do things. And but most of the times, with major motion pictures, you get the film pretty much intact. Yes, yes? It depends on what phase of the film that you're kind of progressing down the road with. I know with television music, yes, they do that a lot. That's what they did for me. That's what they did with my music. And I used to be a score editor where I would take the music of composers and put it into the film. But then I got a contract as a composer, and so they started to put my music in the film. And so there's temp tracks that they use, and a lot of times box music is used as that, temp music that kind of goes in the film to underlie the scene, but later is going to be replaced with music from a composer. But oftentimes, if it's Bach, nobody's really going to replace Bach. So a lot of times that diegetic music is left in the scene. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, technology, okay, my philosophy on this, yes, there will be plenty of opportunities as technology increases. The problem I see in film music today is that you have a lot of young people who are not familiar with the J.S. Bachs and the, you know, Beethovens and this form of music or this form of theory that you learn at, you know, when you go to a conservatory. A lot of kids get garage band and they go crazy, like, you know. And so that, as far as the aesthetics, this is my own opinion, aesthetics of film music, it's being degraded in some sense. The big scores of, great. The big scores is the one we're going to see here. They're being less written these days. I think, and a lot of times with the young composers, they'll have an older guy come in and save the score because, you know, we've gotten away from leitmotifs. You know, a lot of movies you see, there's not a theme, there's no connective tissue. I think there's a resurgence now these days where they're going to be moving back to the thematic. Obviously, Hollywood recognized Bach's contribution to music, and I know most people have seen this, and we'll watch just a little bit of it, but this is Fantasia. How many people, before we watch this, do you know what piece was actually used in the opening sequence of Fantasia? Does anybody know? The original Bach, yeah, Bach. Does anybody know? Okay, I think he actually announces it, but we'll start the clip.
So now we present the Toccata and Fugue in D minor by Johann Sebastian Bach, interpreted in pictures by Walt Disney and his associates, and in music by the Philadelphia Orchestra and its conductor, Leopold Stokowski.
Thank you.
stuff. Okay, so I wanted it to play a little longer because the musical ideas, as obviously when the animators listened to this, they heard certain colors or saw certain things. And as I was telling you before, as a composer, that's kind of how I hear. I actually hear D minor in red. Like when you heard the big cadence there, I don't know if this is from when I was a kid and I watched it, but when I think of the key of D minor, I think of the key of red. And so that's kind of what we saw there. So again, Bach's music influenced, even during the roaring 40s and 50s of particularly of this film. And there's a lot of Mussorgskys in here, Stravinsky. This classical music definitely played emphasis. Now, so here's the next clip that I wanted to show you, and this is where Bach's music is used as non-diegetic music. It's used as underscore music. The score is by Max Steiner, who is one of the greats of the 40s and 50s, the golden era of Hollywood film music. This was a time in Hollywood where studios had orchestras on call, like literally. I mean, you waited for a phone call and you went to the studio, or you were sitting around and they had like scoring stages all over the place where musicians would come and they were played. And it's very interesting. I think one of the things that as film is progressing here, back in the day you used to see the credits for the violinist and the flutes and the oboes. And now all that's been replaced with ILM and visual effects and things of that sort. And I think in a way a travesty in the sense that music is such a big part of film, that to not be given that credit is kind of a travesty, but hopefully it'll be a pendulum swing with that. So I will show you this particular scene. Again, it's the father goes away for war, and the mother receives the telegram, and then we open up with Shirley Temple actually praying to God about her father's safety. Here we go.
Hey, come quick! Miss Hilton!
I pray the Lord and my soul today. And God bless Pop and Mother and Jane and Fidelia and Uncle Tony and Soda. And please, God, make Pop safe. Oh, I know he is safe. You wouldn't let anything happen to him. Please, make him safe anyway. Amen.
Make Bob safe.
Jane, are you awake?
Yes, Britt.
Do you mind if I get into bed with you?
No, I don't mind. Don't let Mother hear you.
And now we're into Max Steiner's score seamlessly. Okay, yeah. So here we have an example of again, a box of music being used non-diegetically, which is not commonly the case. Someone asked that question earlier, but here we have it, even in the 40s and 50s, being used as that. And then as Max Steiner so beautifully does, tails in. You don't even realize that there's a transition that he goes into his film score. And during the 40s and 50s, a lot of film music was written, bookends. I mean, there was a lot of music in these film scores. But even these masters of film scores recognize the masters of the past. And so the next clip I want to show you is from a movie called Love Stories. Anybody remember that movie? Oh, wow. That's awesome. Yeah, I do remember this movie as a kid. although it was made in the year I was born, 1972. Here we have Bach's music serving as diegetic music, and you will see, I won't give it away, actually. Let's see if someone in the audience can figure out which piece is being played, but we'll start that clip here. Great. Does anybody know what work that was? Does anybody here know? Want to take a guess? Or? Okay, well, it's actually a concerto for harpsichord, strings in continuo, number 3, in A major. And just for those who are not familiar with the movie, obviously he's in love with her. And they're at Harvard University. She's at Radcliffe, or she's a Radcliffe graduate, and he's courting her, so he comes to her recital, and there you have the recital. So, but here we have Bach's music being used as a diegetic music. We are not going to do this. That's fine. Yeah. So again, we have all of these principles being used, and Bach's music being used in regard to Claudia Gortman's principles. His music has influence, and what I did, I took films from each era, so from the 40s, the 50s, 50s, the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, and we see this 50-year span where his music is being used. IDMB is a Hollywood base. It's kind of like a database for actors and music supervisors, and they keep track of all the music that's used in films. And I have 22 pages of separate cues of music that Bach has contributed to Hollywood films. I mean, that's 600 to 700 different cues just alone. Most composers don't even attribute that much in their lifetime. So here we have, you know, Bach's influence as far as music in Hollywood being obviously recognized as one of the masters. So that's what I wanted to share with you today. I'm a huge fan of classical music. Again, this has been a great honor to come here and be able to share about how he's influenced my life. As a composer, I've modeled my life after him. In fact, I probably would not be in music had it not been for Bach, Mozart, and Beethoven, and Brahms. You know, I mean, literally 8 years of my life, there was a time I listened to the 3 B's, you know, Bach, Beethoven, and Brahms for 8 years. I missed Andre Crouch during that time because I was classically trained in being in listening to that music. So this is indeed an honor. And I want to open it now up to questions and things of that sort. We had a few, but any remaining questions? Yes. I would say it's definitely more than actually Beethoven, and just his prolific writing. A lot of times, he just has volumes of music, you know, and you have choices. I think, you know, the B minor mass has been used a couple of times, so they'll use something else in his repertoire that has that same kind of quality, or one of his string quartets, or things of that sort. So it's things where he has a huge body of music, and there's plenty of music to draw from. And yeah, he's definitely, as prolific as he is how much as he's used in Hollywood film. Sure. Yes, another question. Yeah, sure. It depends. You mean music that is not, I'm sorry, let me hear.
In other words, like, if you're hired for a film, right, do you also help choose the box
clips? It depends. In the independent level of film music, which is where I kind of, as far as motion pictures, I'm in the independent world. So I do a lot of films that are shot in Sundance, and so a lot of times I'm working with the director as an advisor. So in those cases, yes, I would say, hey, you know, for that particular scene, let's use this music from, I've done that several times, and I go back to Bach a lot of times in that regard, because there's his influence again. With major motion pictures, the big budget films, a lot of times there's a music supervisor that's on board who has a music background of some sort, and they will go and they will select the particular scenes will select the actual music that is used for that. At that point, the composer is just basically focusing on all of the non-diegetic music that is used within to support the narrative. Yeah, yeah. More questions? Oh, yes, yes, sir.
What are some of the great films going to studio out there today? Some of the great recording studio
music? Oh, that's a very good question. I'm so glad you asked, because this is to highlight what is going on in the industry these days. So 33 years ago, there were 22 recording orchestras in Los Angeles. Today, there's two. Yeah, technology is a good thing, but it's kind of a double-edged sword in the sense that it's you know, put a lot of musicians out of work in that regard. Recording studios now can be in your house. As far as major recording studios in LA, there are three scoring stages. Disney has their own, and Warner Brothers has theirs. But there's only three that exist in LA today, when there were a plethora of them. Technology has made it so that it's easy to kind of just record in your home, and in that regard. And so that's kind of the difference from the golden age in the 40s and 50s, the roaring 40s, 50s of film music, where, you know, the love was shared around, you know, musicians, you know, and all. That was when musicians had back end, where they would receive royalties for television for their music being played. And a lot of times now deals are buyouts, or they'll go to the Czech Republic or Romania and record their scores there, because they can get an orchestra to do it for the 10th that the, you know, LA Philharmonic or somebody would do. And so these are the challenges that are in today's film scoring world. And it's changed the art, for sure, definitely from my favorite time of film scoring was during Max Steiner and Bernard Herrmann and Corn Gold and those guys. You know, they wrote thematic, you think of the theme of Laura, you know, David Raskin, those guys, they wrote real themes, real music. And not that that's not happening today, it is in small pockets. And it's the reason why I'm kind of in the independent world, because you have more freedom to kind of do that in the independent world than your big budget films. Yes. Yeah. Yes?
Any films that were entirely or mostly using box scores? City of Slaughterhouse-Five.
Besides that, no, not really, not that I know of. In my research, usually his music is used as again as as diegetic music. So usually it's kind of a period piece, that kind of thing. So, yeah. The Red Violin, there's a couple of segments of his music being, in fact, they actually, there's a segment in the Red Violin where they use Bach's music in that as well. Yes, another, yes. Sometimes it kind of works both ways. A lot of times with the the cocktail party, nobody would have known what that music was going to be, you know, until they get into the final editing stages. With Dreyfuss playing there on piano, because it's so exacting, they have an idea of what the music's going to be. Michael Kamen, I'm sure that's probably the first thing he wrote, as far as Mr. Holland's opus. And so they are able to, they have to track it to the actual piano playing so it looks real. And so a lot of times when you have instances like that, they will know the music beforehand. Yep. Yes. You first, okay. You know, I really think you are, that's a good question. I think they came at a period of time where there was a lot that wasn't discovered. So they discovered it, you know, when it comes to harmony. You know, Beethoven later on taking it to other levels. And then as music started to progress, now you have 20th century music where, so there's it's where you kind of were born in time. You know, and they ran the extent of tonal music. They ran that whole extent of music. And so I think, are there other levels? I believe there are. I just think that we haven't discovered it yet. You know, and when we think, also, you know, Western music is really based off of well-tempered claviers, based off of Western harmony. When you go to other countries, there's different types of harmonies. There's different scales and things of that sort. Ethnomusicology has become a big field nowadays because they're discovering new music in new areas. There's new music coming out of the Amazon that you've not heard. You know, so is that the route to the new music on that level? I doubt it. But you know, I think it's just a matter of the time that they were born and when they were being creative. Yes, you had a question there. I do a lot of independent films. So the last one I did was called White Boy, Brown Boy, and it was about a kid who actually was adopted by an African American family in the 50s during in the South. Very, very controversial film, and that's the latest project that I did. And I kind of more work the independent films. You probably would not, you know, have heard. They play at Sundance and things of that sort. They're on the indie circuit, which is not like the major motion picture things. And I kind of stay in that world because I can be more creative in that world. For now, and that's kind of just where my path is laid. I do a lot of different things, as I said earlier at the top. Adjunct professor, and I play live. This week I'm doing a concert with El Divo. I don't know if you ever heard of them, but I'm doing a pop opera concert with them. So I do a lot of different things. So I kind of let projects come to me. So, yeah. Yes, sir.
I have a question about melodies. I've heard yes. It said that every melody that can ever be written has been written.
I think to the prior question, yeah, I think that's the case in some regards. I just, you know, the pentatonic scale. I mean, how many ways can you skin a cat, basically? You know, I think there is some truth to that. I would say that's true. I think that in Western music, we've kind of reached a pinnacle in that. When you think about the 12-tone scale, it's actually pretty limiting in some ways. When you think about how many actual notes, when you microtonalism and things of that sort, so it has its only ways that it can operate when you think of classical harmony. So I would agree that we're at that state, that every great melody. But there's a way of John Williams is one that seems to be able to pull it out of his hat somehow, just has that gift to be able to take those notes. So yeah, I think we have run the gamut on that. But another question. Yes. Oh man, you opened up a can of worms. Okay. she said, would Bach be pleased how his work, his music is being used in film today, right? I think so, especially if he was collecting royalty checks. Yeah, I think he'd be pretty happy because he's used all over the place. The state of church music today, I think he'd be turned over his grave. That's my, that's my belief of things. But as far as it being used in film music, I mean, that's why I think when it's used in the diegetic sense of things, in its original context and where it should be, I think he would be happy. Yeah, yeah. Yes, ma'am. What was that? I'm sorry. Okay. Yes. Right. Yeah, I think so. She was just asking things like Lynette Bernstein's some children's show production thing, with stuff, things like that be actually happening again. I think so. With La Sistema and different educational groups that are out there, I'm hoping and praying that there is a resurgence of music and the arts. You know, I have to pay for my daughter to go to private school to have to be in an orchestra, or we have to pay for private lessons. It's becoming things of the aristocracy in some sense, and so it's back there. You know, I grew up, you know, where we had band in public school. You know, we had string quartet in public school, and you know, I recently spoke at my school, my high school, in Washington D.C., and I'm sitting in the room that used to be the old band room. And I didn't know actually in my talk that they had X'd out music completely, like completely out of. I mean, it's you can't even take a music lesson or art, you know. And that's where I learned, you know. Besides, you know, supplementing it with private studies and things of that sort. So I really believe that there will be a renaissance of true musician makers and. I think it's happening in different parts of the world. It's just not happening here in the public school sector. And I'm hoping that education will move back that way because it's pertinent. We need that. Yes. Another. Yes, sir.
There's a gentleman locally here, Alan Silvestri.
He's a very dear friend of mine. Yes. Yeah, Alan's a very good friend. He's actually a mentor of mine and a good friend. When you think of the top 30 composers, he's right up there. In fact, I think I mentioned that someone came and saved the score of a younger composer. Well, that was his story. he actually, there was a film score that was kind of going down a drain, and they had given it to a young guy. It was just a film that was just too big for his scope of understanding music, and Alan came in and saved the day. Unfortunately, in Hollywood films, you only have 8 weeks from conception to mix to write the score, and this is easily 92 minutes of music. He actually talked to me when he did the Avengers in London. They actually recorded there, and you only have 92 minutes. So when a guy gets fired, you still have, if he was 2 weeks in, you only have 6 weeks now. If he was 4 weeks in.
I've heard him say that he has about 3 days usually when they give it to him.
Well, in the sense of getting an initial idea, if you're trying to vie for the job, then yeah, you have to write the initial theme to get the job, and then there's the process of recording in the studios and setting that up. And he has a whole operation that he works with, and I've seen it firsthand. Yes? A better. Okay. Right, a better composer. I guess, I don't know. A better composer, because the problem is a lot of times, if you look at a lot of films, there's just basically, there's not really thematic material. If you're talking like John Williams, then yes, I would agree with you. But there are a lot of composers there that there's not much to it. And the concept of composing is all about the interlayings of the music and how that all flows together. You know, how the cellos go with the violins, and it's not just kind of processed music. A lot of composers, okay, so here we are. So a lot of composers today, and these are major motion guys, they don't write out the music. They'll write out 5 lines, and they give it to an orchestrator. So in that regard, that doesn't make you a better composer. Now you're writing ideas, but in the true sense of a composer where it's through composed, and you're writing every line, and I know that tambourine on beat 4 belongs there, it doesn't belong on beat 3 because I wrote it. In that regard, I think there's also this interplay with academia, where academia, you can't go to Juilliard and study film scoring music. Like, I study with Della Gioia, and I could never bring in all my children cues for him to look at. Like, he would have a hissy fit. Like, that's like a no-no. I mean, you know, bring in some, you know, stuff that looks like Messiaen, or, you know, he would have a heart attack with that. So there's the academia hasn't really accepted film score music because of that process of handing it to an orchestrator and having him blow the parts out. And I get it in that field, because you have 8 weeks. That's all you have. So you need people to kind of help you get the bigger the ideas going. Was there a hand over here? I think I missed. Yes, ma'am.
In regard to your seeing music and colors,
yes.
Is that related to
chords? Yes, it is for me. I hear the key of E in yellow. I hear purple for me is G minor. Like I said, the key of D minor is red. Orange is the key of F. And I don't, you know, and it's funny, I'll meet other people who have perfect pitch as well, and it's really weird when we actually agree on the colors. I mean, that gets really, you know, like the key of C is white for me, you know. Key of B flat is blue, you know, and I'm actually hearing the notes as we talk. So yeah, it's definitely an oddity. yeah. There was another hand here. Yes, sir. You had your hand up for it. Okay, all right. Any more questions? Cool. Yes, yes. I would say 20 years or 15 years ago, there was one composer and a slew of guys that helped him process it. And now the state of affairs is, names will be nameless. But there are situations where they do farm out certain cues to composers to write certain parts of the film, and that's where, again, you go back to whether a guy is really is you know And not to knock it at all. I mean, it's just the Hollywood is Hollywood. They want it. They're not going to change the deadline date because you you either got fired or somebody got fired or any of that kind of thing. So it's a process where it's a fast moving process. So when someone writes an amazing score like Williams or there's something to be said by that for sure, definitely. Any more questions? Yes, sir. Sorry.
Perfect pitch, nature nurture. I work with people who learn pitch relations.
Right.
And did very well. Could you expound a little more on your relationship with perfect pitch?
I knew it. My mom discovered it. This is the reason why I ended up playing music. My sister studied piano, and I used to listen to her all the time. And so one day I went down to the piano and played the Moonlight Sonata without reading, basically, and just playing it because of what I've heard. And so I've always had this relationship where it's everything, like, to me. And I also have the relationship where I can't really transpose an instrument and play. Like, because when I see a C on the piano, I see a C, I hear a C. So if a B flat comes out of that C, it makes it odd for transpositions too, like the clarinet, because you see the note, you hear the note. So that's kind of, it's very, I rely on it heavily in music. Yeah. And back to your point of as far as composers being able to capture emotion. As a film composer, that's your primary job, and if you're able to do that, and then you'll have a very successful career. It's about getting into the emotions of people and really, really kind of tapping into that. Hans Zimmer is notorious for that. And the thing is that you can be a not so great composer, but if you're able to grab onto those things that transcend the heart and open emotions, then you've done your job in that sense. Yes. Did I answer your question? Okay, got it. Okay, all right. Any more questions? I'm. It's called Mr. Holland's Opus, and you will love it. Trust me, it's a great film. It's a very heartfelt film. It's about actually what we were talking about, education. He actually ends up losing his job because they're cutting the program. So, yes. Well, thank you. I'll be around. Thank you very much. Sorry for the technical difficulties, but